My name is John, Dr. John Brekke. I have been a faculty member at the University of Southern California School of Social Work since 1984. It is my pleasure today to be interviewing Dr. Marilyn Flynn, who is the Dean of the School of Social Work at the University of Southern California. The occasion is her induction into the California Social Work Hall of Distinction and the California Social Welfare Archives Oral History Collection. Dean Flynn is not only known as a dean, she has an international reputation as a leader in social work, as an innovator, and in fact, she is known among other deans as the Dean of Deans, because they turn to her, because they recognize her intelligence, her clarity, her leadership, and her ability to innovate in this complex world of social work. So it's my pleasure today to be interviewing Dean Flynn, and really this is mostly about your life as a social worker, as you began to think about your emergence into the world of social work. So, how did you become a social worker? What were the influences that shaped that decision?
Well, probably I'm a product of my mother's own odyssey. She was originally an outstanding student at the University of Montana, had the highest grade point in the history of the institution. She applied to the University of Chicago Department of Sociology, which at that time had the most famous sociologist probably of any period in modern sociological development. She was the first woman to receive a fellowship to that department. So she crossed by herself over the mountains to the city of Chicago, which she had never visited before, enrolled in graduate school, completed her courses with great distinction, reached the PhD stage, and she went into her mentor, so to speak, and asked him what should be the topic of her dissertation, did he think? Parks was her mentor. And he said, well, he said, why don't you study what time Chicago school teachers get up in the morning? And this reflects very clearly what she discovered almost from the moment she arrived there, which is the department had perhaps the most misogynist faculty of any department at the University of Chicago. So my mother stood up, she left the office, she walked across campus to the Department of Social Service Administration, where she enrolled in the master's program of social work and subsequently graduated. What I remember as a very small child from the time I was 5 years old is that I wanted a PhD. I didn't know what a PhD was, but I knew I wanted it. And I wanted it in something that had the word social, but I wasn't clear about the rest. So my path was directed from the very beginning, and I explored several fields, sociology and history, political science, Russian studies, believe it or not, and found my way into a PhD program in social work and economics, and graduated. Finally, my mother got her PhD. Took a long time.
So did you get a master's degree and work as a professional social worker along the way?
I did, and I got a master's degree thinking I was going to be a famous psychiatric social worker, which is what just about everybody who graduated in the field thought at that time. So I began as a social worker in the Veterans Administration Hospital, working with largely schizophrenic population of Vietnam veterans who were in various stages of over-medication and active psychosis. So my first day on the job, I was put on a closed, locked ward and told to go interview my patient. My patient told me to go away. I did. I was just panicked. So that was my introduction to practice. That was my first day on the job. But after working at the Veterans Administration Hospital, I went into school social work, and I had spent a very interesting period of time as a school social worker. At that time, you were given the entire school and you were allowed to work at all levels of the school, from the school board all the way down to kids who actually didn't have active problems but needed early attention. It was a really gratifying, important experience. And then I ran a suicide prevention service. It was the first. It was one of the first to use a telecare or telehealth mode. And it was that experience, actually, that convinced me that evaluation is one of the most important aspects of social work practice, that you can do harm as well as good. And it was what brought me really back to the university to learn more about research.
So it was after those experiences that you decided to go back and get a PhD?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And your mother had a very difficult trajectory in academia. Did you experience any of that when you were in a PhD program?
Actually, I thought it was a thrilling experience. I must confess, since this is a no consequence to confession at this particular point, that I enjoyed my work in economics much more than I did my studies in social work. And I think it's because the field of economics is normative in the same way that social work is. But you can actually understand through the kinds of models and the theories that are used in economics what the interactions are between such powerful forces as consumer behavior and government behavior, government spending, and the outcomes for the economy as a whole. It's much more difficult, much more fuzzy and messy to understand the interactions in social work. And of course, that's always been a point of continuing interest of trying to make those interactions more clear. But I was really heard the siren call of economics because I felt it was such a powerful way of understanding how society in the United States, in capitalist, any rate in capitalist countries, some of the most important forces in a capitalist economy operate and how they affect people. And I felt that understanding was essentially missing in the social work literature at that time. Anyway, I loved it. I even loved the courses I nearly failed because they were incredibly challenging, but always very powerful theoretically. And they used mathematics for which I had very little training, so I was generally I was probably the bottom of the class in calculus. But I probably understood more about the market because I came in as a social worker. I understood more about people. So I brought more understanding to the theory than most of my other classmates did. So I would have made a good economist, but I think, even though my math was terrible.
So one of the things I've noticed, Marilyn, is that you have an incredible ability to move across disciplines and to move into venues that social workers have not easily gone into and don't have a a history of going into. Do you think your experiences trying to bridge this world of social work and economics contributed to that?
Yes, I do, but I also think, frankly, it was the environment in which I grew up, because my parents were very intellectually eclectic. My graduation gift was a set of the great books, and I just wept. Not many people cry over books, but I cried because it was the knowledge of the world. Well, that's how people thought at that time anyway. It was the knowledge of the world on two bookshelves. And I had the opportunity to put my hands on every single great work. So, and there was nothing that inspired me more than the thought that I had access to all of those ideas. So I think there was something about my family that really created this passionate interest in ideas and broad swatches of ideas, and made my life a perpetual search for more books on those shelves. I think that was what it was.
So when you began in the field of social work, what was the political climate like in this country? What were the major social forces shaping your experience in social work?
Well, I came into social work probably at one of the best times in the century, as far as I'm concerned. So, you know, the protest movements that started in the late 1950s and then swelled into the 60s and the 70s and dribbled off into the 80s. That was the milieu for me. And so there, it was a sense of enormous possibility and enormous hope and a real belief in social policy and the power of government to change and organize lives. And so it really was this question of whether, if you carefully designed and thought about the nature of programs that you were introducing, there was this sense that you could, in fact, as every social worker wants to do, change the world. And such inspiration. And then it was a period where there was the best and the brightest in Washington. So the debates about social policy and the alternatives that people were considering and the resources, because it was one of the only two times in the 20th century that there was a government surplus. So there were resources. It was social work's probably, it could have been the finest hour for the profession in terms of what we could offer and what we could do. And I have never forgotten that sense of possibility that was engendered when I was in school.
So did you have some mentors or some people who were your intellectual guides? You mentioned having a broad swath of intellectual interests. Were there people or thinkers that particularly animated your mind at those times and when you got into social work?
Well, when it was more being at, I think, being at the University of Illinois, and as I think about it, actually, my first great mentor was Evelyn Millis Duvall, who was really the creator of the whole field of human development at the University of Chicago. And my father worked with her at one point, and I became acquainted with her when I was an undergraduate. And then she was the first person to publish on sexuality, on bringing the whole corpus of human development to not only the field of social work, but broadly to psychology and and social psychology. So her presence in my life as a person who was incredibly successful and incredibly bright, but also she created a field. And so it wasn't just the mentorship, it was watching somebody who was able to create a tectonic shift in a university environment that was really important to me. Because there were so few people like that, certainly in my generation. And when I was at the University of Illinois for part of my graduate work, my mentors were really not in social work. They were in the computer education research laboratory in the College of Engineering. Donald Bitzer, who was the inventor of the plasma screen and the Plato system, which was the first dedicated computer instruction system, was my mentor. I was the only social worker in his laboratory, and I was there because our courses in social welfare history were incredibly dull. Social work was, they were known for their narcotic effects on students. And so I heard that computer-assisted instruction could animate and support learning. I went over to write some programs on social welfare history. And I got I created a character, Herb, who was an impoverished serf in the Middle Ages. And then I took poor Herb through history and subjected him to various afflictions and, you know, then the benefits of intervention through the poor law and so on. And that became the assignment for my students. And they loved it. And we had a wonderful time in my class. And that's when I first developed my interest in, I suppose you'd now call it online learning. It wasn't online then. But computer applications, digital, sort of virtual reality. And so Don Bitzer worked, I worked very closely with him. Was very lucky to have done that. So that's where I got my interest in engineering. Hmm.
It's very interesting to see how all these forces came
right.
together.
Yes.
Family, ideas, academic environments. And you've always been someone who has not seen a boundary as a problem, but as something to span and
right.
to traverse.
Well, it's looking for that extra book on the bookshelf, you know. They weren't all there.
So, you know, you've been very successful at many, many different things. Have you pretty much always experienced success in the things that you've done?
I can't think of a human being who's been successful at everything they've tried, and certainly that does not apply to me. So I would say my greatest success is being here today. That is, considering all of the mistakes that I made, it's remarkable. And I had a enormous struggle completing my education, mostly because I lacked consistency and I lacked focus. So the good part of being interested in many things is being interested in many things, and the bad part is being interested in many things. And I very easily diverted all the time when I was an undergraduate. So I failed, flunked out of the University of Iowa spectacularly. And this is largely due to several bridge tournaments and other things that I got very interested in. So then I had a period when I returned, went back to school. I got straight A's, then I got diverted again. So I actually flunked out. Well, I didn't. The second time was, I would say, deep probation. Twice out of undergraduate school, climbed back up, got a fellowship to go to. I started out in Russian area studies in graduate work. And I would say I was not especially good at that because my Russian never progressed very well. So it wasn't as if there was some linear path to, but I always knew I wanted a PhD. And so no matter how diverted or how confused I was along the way, I simply knew this had to be done. It was early programming always works. And then I think I really have had this persistent challenge as I've gone through my career in trying to really stay with something long enough so that I could be sure that I deeply understood it before I started something new. So I think I've gotten a lot better at that, and I've gotten a lot more intellectually settled. And so I think as a result, I've then been more successful, but probably published much less, probably not developed and sustained the same networks as I would have if I had had a more linear path in life.
So what were some of the successful experiences you had that you've enjoyed the most? I mean, as you look back on your life, not necessarily as you've been a dean or a, but in social right. work in general.
Right. Well, of course, the things I've enjoyed most are the things that I've been able to create. So I created, as I said, the first suicide prevention service in Illinois. And then I transferred that to the first dedicated program for aging people called Telecare in the nation. So it was a progression from recognizing that so many older people are isolated and so on. This became an information and referral service based on a phone line that I created in my work with the Mental Health Association, and we used all Mental Health Association volunteers as staff. So it was tremendously exciting. I created the first labor-based unemployment program in the country at the state level under the Comprehensive Employment and Training Act. I created the first program really in social work in, at that time, called Manpower Development and Employment. And we took a very different track than Columbia University did. And we focused on unemployment rather than problems of employment at the workplace for low-income people. I created the first computer-based programs for older people that were designed to prepare them to re-enter the labor market after they had been. So there's a whole chain of things like this. I was a consultant for Stauffer Chemical Corporation, the first social worker they ever hired, on problems of redundancy and workforce reduction. I created workshops for workers who were being, for the first time in the 130-year history of the corporation, released from employment, as they put it. And my innovation there was to bring the wives in who had never been invited to anything except a corporate dinner, and to do all of the training for labor force reentry with the couple, not with the individual worker. and it was transformational for the company. I conducted the largest survey and the only survey that was ever done of at-risk youth in Michigan, that looked at all of the hours of service, days of care, days of school enrollment, cash transfer payments, hours of counseling. And so that for a one-week picture, we had a snapshot of everything that at-risk kids 0 to 18 received from society in Detroit, Wayne County. And then that was, I took that and created an organization that was designed to provide case coordination and service integration, which was then embedded in county government and operated for some years until the unfortunate economic demise of Detroit. But the beauty, the thing I love that, I truly loved that study because it connected public sector, private sector, every single program across all types of program services, cash services, days of care. And it provided a database that then energized what I thought of was a very rational organization of services and a platform for coordination of services that nobody had imagined. I'm really proud of that.
So you looked at a host of situations and thought about how to make change. Mm-hmm. And what were some of the major obstacles you've dealt with and that you feel you've worked with in your career as a social worker?
Some of the major obstacles are social workers themselves. And I don't say that, I mean, that was my opinion. That's not a, I'm not meaning to condemn the profession, but there's something about the ideological base of our profession, which is motivating and impelling and which gives people the passion for what they do, that absolutely gets in our way when we try to make rational decisions about whether programs are viable, whether alternative directions could be considered, whether we can work with groups such as business. And so I have to say, I found often that people outside the profession understand that better. I can think of alternatives and change processes more readily than people within our own profession. And maybe that is the biggest obstacle.
So you've also had a very high elevation view of our profession. You know, you started by creating programs, and then as you have worked throughout your career, you've had a very 40,000 foot view of our profession. What do you see as some of the major things that have changed in our profession, both for the positive and for the negative, during the course of your career?
It's a wonderful question to think of. I would say as a whole, people are much more sophisticated than when I began. At least that's my impression. I think it's the influence of the PhD programs that matured and have created a whole cadre of persons who just think about the world in different ways. I think the profession has suffered from losing the participation of men. Up until about 1985, someplace in the middle of Reagan's presidency, there was a significant cutback in all of the community development programs, in HUD, in a whole series of settings where federally funded programs had created management opportunities and community organizing activities. And those had been very attractive to men. And with the elimination of those programs, the profession became more feminized once again. And I feel that's a significant disadvantage to us now, but it's a way in which there's been a ebb and flow, I guess, in the profession. I don't see much change, unfortunately, in some of the theoretical material that we teach in our courses. And I wish I could say that I did. And perhaps that reflects the lack of change in social sciences more broadly. There was a long period of quietus after maybe 1950, something like that. So I feel there needs to be perhaps more reflection and incorporation of new areas of thought for us. Not just updating things, but fundamental change. I'm pleased to see that the profession seems to be moving into different arenas than we have been. Much more broadly, I think there's a broader representation of social work, but fewer social work leaders, fewer social work intellectuals, and no public intellectuals among the profession that I know of.
So I just want to ask you a very broad question.
Broader than that other one?
The last one was, this okay. One might even be more broad.
I see.
So if you had to articulate to someone in Congress, why do we need social work in our society? It doesn't have to be someone in Congress, it could be a powerful leader. Why do we need social work? What does it give us that our society wouldn't have?
So there's a very interesting answer to that question that I've only recently adopted. And that is that social work makes the economy a society. And If you say, what does that mean? I recently tried to explain this to a Chinese audience. If you look at Beijing, for example, now, in 2014, you see a place, and Shanghai, you see places of wonderful physical infrastructure. You see the results of a beautifully managed economy that's produced a lot of capital for growth and for economic development. Then why is it exactly at this moment when you would say that this nation is at its best since for a very long time, that they are calling for the development of 2 million social workers? And the answer is that social work is needed to create the glue, the sense of justice and fairness, and the sense of connectedness that brings together the physical infrastructure, the capital development, and ensures that all people can share and participate in the benefits of that development. That's why you need social work.
And you used the example of China. Does the same argument apply in the United States?
Exactly the same argument applies in the United States, because we have the extremes of inequality. And this does not mean suppressing business activity. It doesn't mean demeaning people who have benefited from past growth and development. But it does mean that this is not a place of social harmony. It's not a place of social connectedness. The communities are not anything, we need more than economic communities. We need social communities. And social work bridges the interests of all people in society and ensures that all people here participate. We're interested in the social barriers to those participations, racism, but we're also interested in questions like mental health, which questions that are not limited simply to those who are economically disadvantaged, but these are people who are disadvantaged because they have an illness that prevents them from fully participating in society. Social workers ensure there are bridges for everyone, bridges to social participation.
Mm-hmm. So if you could focus our profession on three issues, what would they be?
So the first issue is the science of social work, because of the importance of social work, because of what I just said, that if we build bridges, we don't want to build them out of cardboard, we want to build them out of sustaining ideas about programs, about interventions, about policies, and we need to do that on the basis of careful organization of data, careful reflection on the results of what we do, careful development of explanations for why things work or why they don't work, people who are self-critical, continuously self-critical, and always looking for the next best hypothesis about what will work. I think probably that is one of the most important things that I can think of. And you're going to have to repeat your question because I got so taken up by that one that I forgot what you said.
Well, there were three, you yeah. had three issues to choose. You could choose two or
no,
four.
No, I'm sure I have three. I just don't remember what you asked. The three most important.
Yeah, that social work should be focusing on as a profession today. One,
okay.
The first
oh,
was
science.
Our scientific
right.
framework.
Right.
Our scientific productivity.
Our identification with the scientific community
yeah. Yeah.
and our use and incorporation in our identity of scientific processes and a scientific attitude, really.
Yeah. And two others.
Yes, and two others. So the second issue is the question of how we address inequality in our society. The second issue is that. And the reason I'm coming to this is that there's been a tendency for the profession to identify strongly, but also exclusively, with persons who are the poorest, the most vulnerable, the most discriminated against, the most extruded, if you like. But if you think of my operating definition of social work, it is a profession that makes us a society. That means we are concerned with everyone. We are concerned by those who can't participate for some reason. Of course we want them to participate, but we also want to strengthen the capacity of those who have been successful. And we don't want to exclude someone simply because they are born into wealth or because they are born into some kind of privilege that others don't enjoy. So I see the challenge here is learning how to talk to the broadest possible audience, not just to one audience, not just to the people whose voices we've heard first. It's to the voices we don't hear, and sometimes the voices we don't hear are people we don't want to listen to because they don't share our ideology. So I think we should be able to talk with the Tea Party. I think we should be, and not just to persuade them, but to understand them and to incorporate some voices from those groups who feel the least familiar, the most foreign. I think it's probably ultimately inclusion as a process of reducing inequality. And the third issue is the way we think about resources. We have a really funny way of thinking about resources. It's not funny. It's very old-fashioned and very tied to our volunteer tradition. So when we think of resources, we think of exactly two things, usually. Number one, money somebody else can give us, and number two, a program involving services to someone. Those are the two things. In fact, the resources that we could develop as a profession are so much more broad. They include resources that we would have from courting powerful allies that we don't have now. It would include resources, we could generate resources by putting some of our best ideas on the private market. We haven't thought of selling what we do. Everybody else does. It's a capitalist economy. Why not? And we have some wonderful ideas. We haven't thought about how to use these very novel ideas that people have related to social entrepreneurship and social innovation, things that mean changing the tax structure or the way people use other kinds of resources, not just going directly to services. So, you know, there's a whole list of things we could think of, but I think it's a huge issue for us because we're going to be in a period of very extended constraint on government resources, and it would behoove us to think differently.
Would you say our field is growing and evolving? And if so, what leads you to believe that?
Is our field growing? According to the Bureau of Labor Statistics, our field is growing. Our field is certainly pervasive in mental health to an extent that was not true even 50 years ago, perhaps, 75. Our presence in health outside of hospital settings is growing and increasing. And there's a potential for diversification of roles that we haven't seen before. The possibility for evolving into new roles in banks, insurance companies, and other non-traditional settings has been demonstrated in our school to a limited extent. And there's still a lot of possibilities for new forms of leadership and so on. In children and family services, of course, which is the kind of stock and trade and historic base for social work, we're certainly identified, I think, as the responsible profession for outcomes in child welfare. Maybe not so much for outcomes of children generally. So I think our field has been evolving. In universities, the number of schools of social work has accelerated enormously since the biggest explosion recently started in 1985, but largely at the undergraduate level. So And the PhD programs have also exploded, expanded, doubled, tripled, moving in on tripling in number. So yes, I think the potential is very strong, depending on how we handle future opportunities.
And you talk a good deal about what you would see as important intellectual horizons for the field to move towards. And so do you see the field growing intellectually enough? Or maybe that's not the right way to phrase this. You already talked about the three things that you think we should be moving towards. But do you feel optimistic about the intellectual growth of our field?
Yeah. So I have put tremendous stock in the development of the American Academy of Social Work and Social Welfare, simply because as a symbolic presence of intellectual leadership, I think it's enormously and fundamentally important to the future. But I don't think it's sufficient, and I think we need some of the, I think we need more than one apparatus for advancement of ideas and advancement of science in our profession. The Academy is very young, very new, and I think it's always better to have multiple assaults on a problem. So I've been very interested in what we've been doing in Islandwood and with the idea of an academy for the advancement of science and social work, or some mechanism that would, some kind of center for advanced studies and at many universities, maybe not just one. And I mention that because I had an appointment to the Center for Advanced Studies and at Illinois, and I was the first social worker, and it was enormously important in helping me to see and understand different strategies for problem solving and different mechanisms for formulating problems and learning how to identify different paths to resolving social issues. And it has always struck me that we're much weaker for not having that kind of mechanism for our profession, where we could bring minds together to think about the most difficult problems and have special opportunities for people to think together. I don't think the American Academy could do that at some point. I don't think they're quite able or ready at this instant. Anyway, I think we need more apparatuses for this. Apparati for doing this. And otherwise, the intellectual development is going to be something that rests on the shoulders, I think, of our most senior faculty and their ability to inspire our best PhD students. Postdocs, we need many, many more postdoctoral programs because this is another engine for advancing intellectual development at the very beginning of people's careers. So we're still very young as a profession, but I'm not sure that people have their eyes fixed on how important these apparati are, these mechanisms are, for creating a truly powerful profession in terms of its intellectual potential. So hopefully we'll all work on this.
So you talked earlier about the importance, and actually a little bit of a worry you have about leadership in social work. Could you talk a little bit more about that?
Yeah. Of course, everybody's always worried. They always imagine the leaders of the past were much better than the current leaders and feel gloomy about the future. And one tends to become more that way the older one gets. So, because the people in the past get more and more romanticized, and you know all your contemporaries, and the future always seems shaky. So, I think we have more university leadership in some of the major research universities than we've had in the past. More influence in major universities than we've had in the past. However, I think the most acute leadership problems are in the practitioner sector, where we have not only lost control in middle management, but the number of people who are leading major public programs who are also social workers is declining. And the variety of programs in which social workers are present as leaders, as highly visible leaders, is declining. And I think that's not just a gloomy statement. I think it's a matter of headcount, really. So I'm very concerned that unless we somehow do a better job of developing the leadership of our of those currently in middle management out in the world, and those who are still in the university, and preparing them for a more complex and urbanized environment, and preparing them for competition with other disciplines that have more rigorous theories but less understanding of complexity. I am very concerned about whether we will be able to exercise the level of influence we should to create the society that we all want.
Mm-hmm. So when you're working to inspire students and young people to move into our profession, what are the things that you like to tell them about social work and about what they can accomplish?
I like to tell people of all ages that social work is unique. It's the only profession that's concerned with all of the institutions in society, and it is the only profession that is concerned with doing great good by involving all of those institutions. Every other profession has a focus. It's either focused on the courts or the hospitals, or it's focused on the I can only think of two building bridges or infrastructure. We alone think of the entire sweep of human institutions and the entire sweep of the human condition. We're the only ones that do that. We have the broadest view. We have the broadest capacity for doing great good. And for anybody who wants to change the human condition for the better, it's the most powerful profession.
So is there anything else you'd like to comment on, or anything we haven't talked about that you would like to discuss comment on?
I think that the one thing we haven't talked about is really the social work community itself, and that is how we as a community can come together in this very complicated and global age. There, and I mean the community in the broadest possible sense. All of the countries with emerging markets develop social work almost simultaneously, because villages, all traditions, families, everything is disrupted. The need for social work emerges instantly. So we have this whole group in Indonesia, down through Central and on our own continent, through Central America, and down throughout the Americas, in China, Russia, elsewhere. So we have this emerging community of social workers in the world. And then we have American social work and European social work, which between the two of them are very different in the way they think of the world. So we have world congresses from time to time, but we don't have the same kind of connection and conversation that I see people in the sciences carrying on today. People in the sciences are constantly talking with each other because they recognize that people in other countries actually know things we don't know, and they're solving things we can't solve. And we don't have that, we just don't have that idea here. We have the idea of American social work. And then occasionally we invite a few people in, or we go to a conference someplace else. It's not a global community in the same way that biology, chemistry, math, other sciences are. So that is the thing that I would hope we could all really focus on for the future. And that is how to make those connections to begin with, and then how to grow them, given the fact that we are all living geographically very separate from each other. We have different languages and all the other usual impediments. And we don't have math. If you have math, you can solve a lot of things. We don't have math, so in the absence of that, maybe translator programs will help us someday soon. I don't know.
Okay, so as a final question, what can people who are entering this field or who are in this field, what can they learn from your experiences as you've created a career in social work? When they look to you as a model, what do you think they can learn from you and what you have done and what you've accomplished? Not necessarily an intellectual accomplishment, but your personal qualities that you think others can learn from and emulate.
I think the one single attribute that I'm most proud of that has been the most helpful to me when I choose to remember it and take advantage of it is the ability to look at people's comments and ideas and so on as information, not as a personal attack or something I'm opposed to or something I'm not interested in or something that is stupid, or any of the other dismissive and mechanisms we use to trivialize what other people have to say. And whether it's sitting in a budget meeting or talking to a group of people who are not particularly friendly, or sitting in a room where everybody has more status than I do, that's whenever I start to feel frightened or feel I have incompetent or attacked or all the other things we feel when we're in an uncomfortable, strange, or unfamiliar situation. I just say to myself, this is information. It changes. It's like the optometrist who turns the lens and says, now, can you see more clearly? It's like that. And then I feel myself relax. I can listen. I actually think. And if I don't like it, it doesn't seem to bother me. And so if I were, I don't know if I've explained it clearly enough, but it is the thing I'm the most proud of. And it's the thing that lets me to go walk into any room and never feel outdone or intimidated.